That which is has already been, and what is to be has already been, and God requires an account of what is past. Ecclesiastes 3:15. You know, if you could pick one of the wildest topics in science fiction, it would surely be one of the alternate dimensions and virtual worlds. With programs like Sliders and The Matrix, the imagination is truly stimulated. But hey, it's only fiction, right? What if I could show you that in the Bible tells us that Jesus alluded to the very fact that this mortal life, our linear existence, is actually an altered dimension, separated from the eternal one, yet existing at the same time? Sounds kind of weird? Consider just what the scripture above, that I just quoted says. Our past and our future have already been done, and God requires an account of what is past. The implication is that to God, everything is already past history, and he requires an account for it all. It is not that God is sitting up in eternity and has a plan all figured out and knows what he's going to do. It's already been done. You can't hedge around this one. Clearly, by that statement alone, heaven, God's dwelling place, a place of eternity, is outside of time. The outcome of everything is already history from God's perspective. That is why we have this supernatural book called the Bible, which actually holds the entire recorded history of mankind from beginning to end. The Bible is not just a collection of stories, poems, and accounts of isolated incidents between man and God and Satan, locked in some kind of struggle for freedom or victory. The Bible literally means the book. Not a book, but the book. On the contrary, every book, story, and poem in the Bible is interconnected to explain one story. This is a story of a creation altered and separated from God's original intended condition by a rebel who tried to create for himself his own universe. It is the complete story from start to finish of this distortion of time and space, resulting in the creation of a paradox universe. God's creation then being trapped in an alternate existence and in need of rescue. It is the account of an all-loving God for his creation who restored and repaired this alternate linear dimension by making the ultimate sacrifice himself. In the form of his only begotten Son, God became man to restore first spiritually, then physically, all of creation and to put an end to the rebel and his followers, both angelic and human. To understand a concept of eternal versus linear, our concept of time can be the biggest problem. It is hard for us to realize the concept of eternity being trapped in a linear existence. We only experience the present and remember the past and speculate the future. God, who dwells outside of time, sees and experiences it all at one time. Imagine standing on a street corner watching a parade go by. One by one, you see the various floats and bands pass by until the end. Someone high above in a helicopter would be able to see the entire parade as one single event. At least in perception, the same can be said of heaven and earth, linear or eternal existence. Though God lives in the completed eternal state of everything accomplished according to his will, he has access to the linear state in a parallel to his state at any time at any point. Going back to our illustration, not only can you observe the entire parade being up above, but you also have the ability to enter into that parade at any given point or time that you choose, as you see and view everything as one single event. Heaven and earth, eternity, linear, are coexistence and yet very different, and the Bible describes both further. The eternal dimension, there's many descriptions mentioned in the Bible that give us a glimpse of what eternity can be like. First off, in Isaiah 57:15, the word says, "For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I will dwell in the high and holy place with him that is of a contrite and humble spirit." This scripture depicts the nature of God being in harmony with the abode of God, eternity. From the understanding of the Hebrew language, we get a good description of and a glimpse of what eternity is like. God is described as being the high and lofty one. He is actively raised, one in all applications of the word raised, as in a higher level, but he is also the Nasa, or the one lifted up, as in resurrected. His name is holy, or to be clean, by eminence, sacred, apart from imperfection or sin, which is missing the mark. He dwells in this high and holy place, an elevated place, a place of perfection without sin. Also, again, meaning to not miss the mark, a deviation of the intended objective. Eternity is like a circle outside of time. The high and holy place is called eternity from the Hebrew word adah, to advance, pass on, or continue. Strong's definition makes the point, let's get this one, a preemptory terminus, by implication, duration, in a sense of an advanced perpetuity. Now, I have to confess, I had to look at my Webster's to understand what Strong was saying and putting it into simple English. To simplify, it is putting an end or precluding a right of action, a final absolute final goal or boundary, either end of a transportation line or travel route. The final state is being perpetual without end or beginning. In this sense, what is being described is taking a line from the beginning point and the ending and wrapping it together at the ends to form a circle. No beginning or ending, but continuous. This is an act stated in the above scripture context exclusively the right of God for the price he paid. The Bible actually describes this as eternity and perhaps the actual means to accomplish this eternal state. Jesus, just before God was to reveal closing events to the Apostle John, Jesus reaffirmed this idea when he said, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is, which was, and which is yet to come, the Almighty," recorded in Revelation 1:8. Jesus said to John that he was the Arche, or the Telos, the first estate, corner, or beginning of time, and the conclusion of, as in a levy paid, of a definite point or goal. He then concluded by saying he was the Almighty, or in the Greek, Pantokrateo, one holding all authority over everything, including both dimensions. Before the prophet Daniel revealed to Nebuchadnezzar his dream, as God revealed it to him, he made this inspired statement: "How great are his signs, and how mighty are his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion is from generation to generation." Daniel 4:3. In the Aramaic, Daniel describes the kingdom as everlasting, or alam, a remote time, future or past, indefinitely, forever. Alam corresponds with olam, being veiled from sight, concealed from the vanishing point. Giving it this flavor to the word, from generation to generation, is imdar, which is to say associated by huddling together, a revolution of time, an age, a dwelling. It is from the root from dwar, meaning to gyrate, to move in a circle, or to remain to dwell. Again, the etymology of these words, we get the idea of a forming of a circle as a state of eternity. In the New Testament, Jesus is described as according to the work whereby he is able to even subdue all things unto himself, Philippians 3:21. This gathering to form a circle includes only what was intended to be created. Everything that was mixed up or incomplete will be made right according to his will and purpose. The next text of scripture includes this idea. We have to understand the eternal realm is totally exclusive to God. In Ecclesiastes 3:11, he has made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he has set the world in their heart so that no man can find out the work that God makes from the beginning to the end. In this text, he hath made everything beautiful in his time is describing a promise that everything in his linear temporal time will be made right in his own time. The word used for times is eth, from the Hebrew root ad. This would indicate that the suitable time is apart from the linear realm and one of completion in God's eternal realm. This next verse clarifies this idea, describing man's position as being apart and incomprehensible in man's own reasoning from God's eternal dimension. Vine's notes on Strong's numbers puts it best. In Ecclesiastes 3:11, we read that God had bound man to time and given him the capacity to live above time. In other words, he could remember yesterday, plan for tomorrow, and consider abstract principles, yet he has not given him divine knowledge. Divine knowledge of eternal things would only be imparted to fallen man as he needed it or as he is conformed into God's likeness. It is not that God is afraid of man competing with him or enjoying some kind of role as master. It is for our own safety and care that he prevents us from knowledge that we would abuse and harm ourselves with. He would not give a child a loaded gun to play with, even with proper instruction. He would only abuse or misuse it by the very nature that he is only a child lacking wisdom. The same immaturity exists with fallen man. We have a nature in this linear existence that would only abuse the knowledge and power of heaven. We lack wisdom to understand the whole picture from God's perspective, limited by our own linear existence and the limitations natural to it. To usurp this is to become a rebel and a spoiled child demanding to play with a loaded gun. We thereby have been limited in our access and understanding of certain knowledge only for our protection. Our trust then is not to cross certain boundaries of concealed knowledge or what is today called occult knowledge and rely upon sufficient grace through God's revealed means. In doing this, we are promised an abundant life able to sustain us and keep us through for the short time we are here in this distortion of a dimension we call mortal life. These scriptures backed up the principles is in John 10:10, Jude 1:24-25, Psalms 55:22, and Philippians 4:19. To try and grasp this understanding of eternity, we need to see it as the linear timeline of mankind's total history, wrapped up from end to end, purged from anything not in God's intended creation, and connected into a circle of His perfect will. No past, no future, only now, with all things coexistent with each other and made perfect in His will. This, of course, has already been done in another parallel dimension, heaven. We get a glimpse of these two points coming together. Consider the condition we find the earth in described in Genesis 1. In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. In the Hebrew words, tohu and bohu are used here to describe the conditions of the earth. It is more commonly accepted that the translation should be desolation and laid waste, with death and despair upon the face of the deep, or abyss. Because of this preferred meaning, which I believe is more accurate and true to word mechanics in this context, a problem exists that requires some reason for this destructive state of earth. The only thing that seems to have logic to explain these two words, what is called the gap theory, is the idea between verses 1 and 2, many years, even millions of years, may have existed between the two verses, as some make the claim. This gap also includes an assumed pre-Adamic rebellion of Satan and his angelic followers against God and his angels that left the earth in this destroyed condition. There are no actual scriptures to support these ideas, and what proof is offered are no more than vague allusions that are very debatable and a few scriptures that are taken out of context. The biggest problem with the gap theory is the literal 7 days of creation. Is time in God's perception the same as ours and defined in 2 Peter 3:8, or is there a difference? And if there is a difference, where is the scripture reference for it? There are none to my understanding of the scriptures, not only just man-made rhetoric. The other problem is that of Satan's fall. The Bible clearly states that Satan was placed in the Garden of Eden as God's super cop to protect and serve his new creation, mankind. Here is the text of scripture in Ezekiel 28:13-15, condensed. Thou hast been in the Garden of Eden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou wast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created, till iniquity was found in thee. Satan was God's super cop placed in the Garden of Eden to serve God's new creation by protecting and provoking growth as a service to God and mankind. Every precious stone was his covering, means as construction elements they were used as an intertwining fence for protection. The original Hebrew actually reads this out. This could be the electromagnetic energy grid covering the earth that was supposed to protect God's creation, but now locks us into a linear existence that separates us from the rest of the eternal realities. It is also the pathway of the angels mentioned by Enoch, and the possible physics as to how this rebel cherub is the prince and power of the air. This describes his function in the first heaven around earth. To be in the holy mountain of God is the third heaven, God's domain. The stones of fire is the second heaven, our natural universe or outer space. In context, all three of this triple-decker heaven is described for Satan's functions. When was iniquity found in him? In the Garden of Eden, when he tempted Eve. He offered mankind two lies as provisions and traded their heritage for them. The trick was that the two lies were already part of their original inheritance in the first place. You shall surely not die, cloning as the imitation mockery of that. Your eyes shall be open and you will be like God. To understand forbidden knowledge, to think you can be all-present, all-knowing, and all-powerful, is to travel interdimensionally like God and to exercise that same power. That dimension, we will see, is time and the ability to travel it. Understanding the beginning of the earth and the end of the earth coming together to make a new heaven and a new earth, that is exactly what we see described in Genesis 1 and 2, and does not require a gap at all. It is a description hard to understand by our perception of space and time, but one that God gives us a glimpse of as the culmination of all things viewed as one single event. Linear time was not in God's original intention. This first fact that is very important to establish in your thinking is the fact that the whole dimension, the earth, the sky, the heavens, all that contained in this material universe is included as being outside of God's intended design kingdom. Let us consider what Jesus said to Pilate as he was brought before the Romans for trial. In John 18:36, Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence." Pilate therefore said unto him, "Are you a king?" Jesus answered, Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone that is of the truth hears my voice. Foolish misquotes of this scripture have tried to suggest that Christ was an extraterrestrial. By going back to the original language, this is not even remotely what is implied. Jesus said that his basilia, realm and rule, was not of this cosmos, with a K-O-S-M-O-S. That's the orderly arrangement adorning the total sum of the material universe. Clearly, this spatial realm we call our universe, our linear existence, is not God's order. It is separated and apart from God's intended creation. Yet at the same time, the Bible tells us that all things were created by God and nothing was created without Him. 1 Colossians 1:16 and 17. By this, there is the understanding of rulership. God is in control of everything. Nothing is beyond His control. There is, in this sense, a creation by extension. God created Satan, who then fell and imitated creation by his deceiving Adam and Eve. This deception placed them in the distorted linear dimension and produced mortality and death waiting in the end. This distorted creation is an imitation by Satan and a parallel universe to the real thing. It is, however, ultimately the creation by extension from God, who is still in control, as this is all part of his plan to mature a relationship with his creation. Our mortal linear existence is actually an alternate universe. This statement makes that fact quite clear. Jesus' follow-up statement to Pilate states his intentions and purpose on earth in this linear dimension. He did not come to be a king and set up rule, but to make a way for his creation back to where they belong in eternity with him. This whole universe or dimension will come to an end, according to 1 John 2:17. It will not be redeemed or changed into a utopia with world peace for more than a holding pattern of 1,000 years, as mentioned in Revelation 21. Then it will end with a new heaven and a new earth, according to Revelation 21:1. Now that we understand this whole physical realm or dimension we call mortal reality or mortal life is outside of God's intended creation, we need to understand just how we got there. There was a garden, two trees, and a wrong decision. Our original intended heritage was quite different from what resulted. Man was created with the intention of being an eternal being to live and have fellowship with God. God's desire was to share all that he was and had with his creation. While the specifics are not mentioned in Genesis, along with the rest of the well-known story, these facts are revealed as the promises of reconciliation by faith in Christ's work on the cross. Why were we created? Some false prophets today are claiming that we were created to be a slave labor force to mine this planet by the so-called Elohim. Nothing could be farther from the truth. Revelation 4:11 says, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are all and were created. Not that His pleasure was for us to be subordinate slaves. Jesus expounded on just what the Father's pleasure was concerning us. In Luke 12:32, Jesus said, For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Romans 8:17 says, And if we are children of God, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. Revelations 3:13 and Matthew 28:18 says that Christ is given all power in heaven and earth. Both domains are in his ultimate control and we will be joint heirs to the eternal one with him. The awesome reality is that we are to be as brothers to the very one who redeemed us. This certainly does not sound like a God who is afraid of competition from his own creation, as some recent claims have been made. There is a final offer to a portion of mankind who has accepted the only way of redemption, the only way back to the eternal dimension. It is this group of people reconciled to God that may freely eat of the other tree, the tree of life. In Revelations 2:7, Revelations 22:14, I hope you can see from these few scriptures that the original creation and intentions of God was to share all that he is, all that he has with his creation, to be an undeserving equal part in all of creation eternally, and to rule. Two naked people, a man and a woman, a tree and an apple and a snake. Really. First, let's take a look at the tree. There's a whole lot more to this story than what appears to be on the surface. And by going to the original languages, we'll examine this further. The Hebrew word for tree used in Genesis 2:9 has an emphasis on the product from its origin to be utilized in the sense of making firm or fasten, to close or to seal. In this sense, the tree is more of a door or gateway. The word for tree also has much in common with the Hebrew word for generations. It is how and why we get the cultural idea of a family tree, with trunk, branches, leaves, and fruit. This tree could symbolically be suggesting an opening to another dimension. With this in mind, the two trees of Genesis, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the tree of life, could represent pathways or dimensional portals whose entrance depends upon a decision of faith or disobedience in the form of self-reliance. The fruit, which the Bible said was never really an apple, is the catalyst that transforms man, time, and space into a mortal, linear existence. This was never the intention of God, but the result of a wrong decision by man. And what about the serpent? Now the serpent was much more subtle than any beast of the fields which is the Lord God had made. And the Lord God said, "Because you have done this, you have cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life." Genesis 3, 1 in part, and also 14. Are we but to believe that the initiator was a snake or a temporarily demonized one? Again, by going back to the Hebrew word usage, quite a different picture and claim could be made. Nakash, the Hebrew word for serpent, means snake from its hiss. Its root word means to enchant or to prognosticate. The emphasis is on the action of the snake as being like a snake, not necessarily that it is a snake. Dr. Henry M. Moore states in his book, The Genesis Record, that some scholars maintain that Nakash originally meant upright, shining creature. This would give a whole new perspective to the serpent. He is said to be subtler than all other creatures created by God. Subtle means intelligence applied in a crafty or manipulative manner. This certainly is not talking about the reptile we know as a snake. In Genesis 3, we get the illustration that because the serpent deceived Adam and Eve, he would be made to crawl in his belly and eat dust for the rest of his life. Again, going back to the original language, the redefining of these words in light of 21st century knowledge takes the story to another very realistic twist. The Hebrew El Gashwan Yalak for upon the belly and life can actually mean from above a reptile as superior, from the issue of the fetus as being outside the belly, you will continue on in your material life. Only in modern times could this scripture be understood for what it might imply. A superior reptilian form that carries on life outside of normal reproduction can be by the means of cloning. A seraphim is an order of angelic being. In word etymology, seraphim means reptile in Sanskrit. Even Drs. Young and Strong in their concordances of the Bible concur with these word definitions without drawing rather these strange conclusions. Dr. Spiros Zahadius, Ph.D., comments on the Hebrew-Greek study Bible about the word cursed in Genesis 3. This word has been interpreted as meaning to bind with a spell, to hem in with obstacles, to render powerless, to resist. Thus, the first curses in Genesis 3, 14 and 17, "Thou art cursed above all cattle, and cursed is the ground for thy sake," means you are banned from all other animals, and condemnation be the soil. The example, its fertility to men is banned on your account. In light of this possible meaning to the scriptures, just who or what then is this Nakash? The evidence is uncanny. As a former member of MUFON, Mutual UFO Network, a serious organization composed of professionals from the scientific community, as a UFO researcher, the alleged information about these so-called grays line up right with this possible understanding taken from the scriptures. It is said with an agenda that follows that these grays are of superior intelligence, having two brains. They do not possess sexual organs and have sensory organs that are somewhat atrophied. They say they continue on life by transferring their consciousness to a cloned replica of themselves when damaged. They are reptilian in nature and have the ability to hypnotize or freeze their victims. They claim to have created mankind and are here to bring us up to the next level of our evolution. They are seen in bright, sudden, startling appearances from the skies. Their bodies also appear to shine in the dark. Redefining the tree and the serpent in this way gives us a much more realistic 21st century setting for what is happening in the Garden of Eden. There was a wrong choice made that was putting man in a lesser state, spiritually separated from God, physically in a lesser form, and placed into an entire altered dimension. Regardless of whether you believe the tree, fruit, and serpent are literal or alluding to something more elaborate, the fact remains that mankind made a wrong choice. The result was that man was sent out of the garden. The garden suggests potentiality. If you have a garden, it is a place sectioned off with the anticipation of producing beauty or fruit. In our case, it produced a necessity for man to leave. Imagine a circle, and with that circle is the potential of the garden. With the wrong choice having been made by Adam and Eve, the line is projected out and away from the circle. In effect, this is what happened as a result of the Eden experience. The biggest con job ever to put on anyone is here in the Garden of Eden, where it says in Genesis 3, 1, 4, and 5, "Now the serpent was more subtle, crafty, intelligent than any beast of the field which the Lord God made. And the serpent said to the woman, You shall surely not die, for God knows in the day that you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." In the Hebrew, Tov and Ra are used for good and evil. The roots mean to make good or to spoil. In this sense, the words are depicting a quality or state of being, as well as knowing the difference between the two. This is where the smooth deception is deployed. Adam and Eve were already in the image of God, according to Genesis 1:27. They had completeness both spiritually and physically. God walked with man. There was a complete spiritual harmony. There was also a complete physical harmony. I believe man had full use and potential of his brain's capacity. His very biology was also in harmony with God's intended desire. Had Adam and Eve turned down the temptation of the serpent, they would have been invited to eat from the tree of life. They were truly first-class creations. They were just not aware of it or anything different from it. By partaking of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they became aware of this difference only because they were now in a lesser state. Their very biology had changed by making this wrong choice. Now they became a second-rate creation. Their eyes did become open, and in the lesser state they became as naked before God. This change was obvious in their hindered state. With only one-tenth of their brain capacity at hand and an addition of a blood system, they were made fragile and mortal. This addition of a blood system is very important. It was this addition that projected this line of existence away from God and eternity into a linear mortal existence. There are scriptures to support this idea.
From the dawn of time we came, moving silently among you, immortals.
Before we address the biblical perspective on blood and its relationship to the parallel dimension, we have to address the cultural beliefs and practices that are part of our human history. The idea of vampires may be a conditioning by Lucifer through human agents to steer mankind to an ultimate prophetic end. With that said, let's look at the history of myths, legends, and pop fiction on blood and vampires. I hope to show you a progression or regression or digression that is steering mankind to an ultimate end and game delusion. Forgiveness of sin, the promise of eternal life, and a required sacrifice of an innocent death in association of blood is a primary theme in the Jewish and Christian belief system. It has been often misunderstood by those outside of the faith and even mocked by others in religion, myth, and fiction. Many pagan religions have taken the Judeo-Christian concepts and reversed them, whereby instead of God making the sacrifice for mankind, mankind sacrifices humans with the drinking of blood and the eating of human flesh to sustain immortality or pleasing and placating the desires of various godlike deities. Legends and myths of blood-drinking, flesh-eating entities associated these acts for themselves with obtaining the power of eternal life or universal. This kind of fascination about blood has been with us throughout history and has a variation in almost every culture and mankind. In ancient Egypt, the Sekhmet, a female deity, drank blood. In India, the goddess Kali had fangs, wore a necklace of human skulls, and drank blood of human sacrifices. In Asia, the Aswang are still a popular culture myth. In China, it was the Yangtze. Africa, the Impundula. South America, the Sukov Yant and Tunda, and the Patal Sola. In the Arabic world, some of the jinn had the same characteristics of blood-drinking practices. The oldest versions are found in ancient Babylon. A deity, Lilitu, was known for drinking the blood of babies. This deity shares the legend as possibly being that of Lilith. The ancient Aztecs offered up young victims to the Quasicuilto to ensure fertilization of the earth. Similar practices by the Incans and Mayans did the same for their gods. Both Greek and Roman mythology included deities with vampire characteristics and the power of human blood to create new or eternal life. Ancient names like Lemi, Impasu, and the Strigus later evolved to become the general terms for medieval European witches, demons, and vampires. Two demon types developed from this are the well-known succubus and incubus, seductive sexual blood drinkers who set the stage for the popular myths of vampires today. Voltaire's writings took these ancient myths to a new level of popular interest, and he is attributed as a turning point for inspiration for future authors. In the 1400s, Prince Vlad Tepes of Transylvania became a hero in Bavaria for pushing the Ottoman Empire from their land. He was called the Impaler for his bloodthirsty slaughter of his enemies by impaling them on poles. It's alleged that he drank the blood of his dying victims. His life was the inspiration for the most famous book by Bram Stoker, which came to print in 1897. The first actual novel about vampires came out in 1817 by John Paladin's The Vampire. In both cases, the vampires were human-like but kept the grotesque monster-like qualities and features from the ancient myths. The first Hollywood movie, A Fool Was There, portrayed the other ancient myth of the female seductive type of vampire. This movie featured silent movie actress Theda Bara as the sexy seductress. The movie was based on the first poem about vampires by the famous Rudyard Kipling and is considered the first vampire movie. The second major Hollywood work reverted back to the male undead monster-like human in the movie classic Nosferatu. This male ghoulish seducer remained the status quo for the next several decades, with a progression of more human-like attributes, even to the point of being rather attractive enough to seduce women into their lifestyle as willing followers. But Hollywood would also add an occasional female vamp seductress just to keep the male population interested also. The TV movie Dark Shadows, a daytime soap opera, began to make the audience see a more human drama played out within the vampire lore. Females across America and Europe became fascinated with the human drama of the vampire as a greater depth and dimension to the personalities existed and was explained prior to their mishap of becoming a vampire. Suddenly a transformation was taking place that beckoned the mainstream to accept the vampire as less of a monster and more of an entity to have compassion and understanding for their unwanted plight. We still had the fearful monster types with Christopher Lee and the Bela Lugosi types, but we also had the comical grandpapa of the monsters. Vampires became diverse and acceptable. In the early 80s, with Vampire Diaries and Tom Cruise's Interview with a Vampire, the role became that of a rather handsome, sexy victim. Now the female members of society began to see a romantic fantasy regarding vampires. At the same time, we had very attractive female vampires as hosts of horror shows like Elvira, and that also kept the male population interested and filled with a desire. Something else began to evolve from this conditioning by Hollywood at the same time. A subculture started to evolve worldwide called the Goths. This subculture desires and even emulates many of the occult, hellish, and devilish practices, including the drinking of blood and believing that they are real vampires. Some aspects of this subculture intellectualize their social lifestyle as innocent entertainment or justified reality. Further digression from Hollywood has taken the whole occult topic of blood, vampires, wolfmen to the next level, from sympathy to a new realm of desire through romanticizing them. With the hit book series Twilight by Stephanie Meyer, mainstream America and families across the globe have fallen in love with the vampire characters and now become obsessed with them. The town of Forks, Washington, where the fiction story was based on, has become the new Roswell for vampires. Suddenly, June and Ward Cleaver has invited the things of death and darkness into their lives under the guise of romance, fun, and fantasy. The whole topic of vampires through the decades of the last century has progressively made society accept and even desire the vampire concept. We are now saturated by this idea, just like aliens. Our children grow up from the beginning with vampires and continue on playing video role games, comics, and right into adulthood with adult graphic comics, daytime soaps, and romance novels. Recently, the Sci-Fi Channel has even combined vampires as being aliens. This has always been a theme that has been a campy, B-rate, fluffy thing of the past, but the Sci-Fi Channel has upped the ante on presenting an in-depth drama. The storyline goes that a dying planet of vampire-like aliens colonize the Earth by infiltrating and integrating themselves into human society. They are known to us as all of the famous innovators, discoverers, and also heinous criminals, having both good and evil members of their society that have infiltrated and integrated themselves into our human experience. They fight against each other, and man is kind of stuck in the middle, unknowing of the hidden history around them. This parallels so much with biblical prophetic end-time warnings that it is no coincidence. This graphic was from a Gothic website. The inclusion of such a composite iconic illustration is acknowledgement that some Goths at some level know exactly what they're into. Notice the three aspects of this illustration. We have a goat-headed human-like creature inside the pentagram and a serpent circling around the entire picture. The goat is Satan. The pentagram signifies his five-point plan mentioned in Isaiah 14 as the mystery of iniquity, also mentioned by the Apostle Paul. The Ouroboros, which is the iconic name for the serpent with his own tail in his mouth, is symbolic of Satan's ultimate goal to make this linear dimension into an eternal one. Funny how this is in association with the vampire legends in Gothic society. This Gothic culture also connects vampires with the Nephilim mentioned in the Bible. Interesting to note, in Genesis 6 we find unusual events happening with fallen angels that interbred with human women. The result was giants, or in the Hebrew, Nephilim. They were described as bullies and tyrants toward the rest of mankind and played with them unmercifully. These entities are known in history as all of the cultural tales of mythology. Yes, these creatures were real and the myths are just a faint memory of that time. The Book of Enoch further describes this pre-flood time and the society that existed then. Some of these Nephilim began to kill and eat humans or drink their blood. What is even more important is to realize that Jesus said about this time, just as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. In context, Jesus was describing events that would lead up to his second appearance at the end of time. Vampires and the biblical Nephilim have the same characteristics and are probably one and the same and soon to return as warned. But wait, there's more. Some are already here and have been here throughout time as immortals, coexisting with human society, steering it towards a one-world religion, government, and monetary system. Let's look at this text in Jude. These are they who were of old. These are spots in your feast of charity when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Clouds are they without water, carried about of winds, trees whose fruit withereth, without fruit twice dead, plucked up by the roots, raging waves of the sea, foaming out of their own shame, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Clouds without water, twice dead, wandering stars, reserved for everlasting darkness are three descriptions of fallen angels, not humans. Understanding this connection, you can see why the promotional campaign evolved throughout our history is about to come to completion. Human society is being made ready to accept these entities as beneficent aliens come to help mankind at our darkest hour. You see many embrace the weird, macabre culture of the Goths who already know this and the unsuspected masses who blindly embrace a romantic fantasy soon to become all of our reality. Next, we will learn what the Bible has to say about the power of blood. Blood in, blood out. It was blood that got us into a mortal existence, and a different blood that once shed would bring us back to the previous existence. Adam's statement in regards to the newly formed Eve, he said in Genesis 2:23, and Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh." I believe the absence of the mention of blood is very important. This was before the temptation, and they had no blood as they were created like their father. After the resurrection, Jesus describes himself not as a spirit, but as a living being, flesh and bone minus blood. He is in the eternal state without blood, as recorded in Luke 24:39. The life of the flesh is in the blood. That's the Levitical law in Leviticus 17:11. Mortal life is in the blood. This mortal life was given only as a result of the wrong choice during the temptation. Blood is the only dietary law carried over into the New Testament, being absolutely prohibited from eating. In Leviticus 17:10 and Acts 21:25. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, 1 Corinthians 15:50. In God's eternal kingdom, only perfection according to his will can exist with him, flesh and blood not included. There's two types of flesh and blood, or flesh. I must conclude here that the two types of flesh, as defined by the Bible, each belonging to a separate dimensional existence. 1 Corinthians 15:39 and 48. It's long, but I think it's essentially important to read this right from the scriptures to get a full understanding from a 21st century perspective just what Paul was trying to get across to us here. He says, "All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, another of birds. There are also celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial. but the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is one glory of the sun, there is another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars, for one star differs from another star in glory. So is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first Adam was made a living soul, the last Adam was made a quickening or a life-giving spirit. Howbeit this was not first, howbeit that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural. Afterward that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earth, the second man is the Lord from heaven. And as is earthly, such are they that do earthly things. And as is heavenly, such is they also that are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Mortal life, then, being produced by the addition of a blood system from a wrong choice, is further defined from the above text. This is a glory of a terrestrial body, but it was created in corruption, dishonor, and weakness that only produced death. Existing in this form, we are natural and inclined to behave in this natural environment and manner. It is not our fault, as if we had any choice in the matter, all descendants afterward would simply behave and take on the nature that this linear environment dictated. That was the whole point and mission of God becoming a man. The second Adam would undo what was done in the Garden of Eden in the same matter, only with the elimination or pouring out of a blood foreign to the influence of this altered state. Man was exiled from eternity for his own protection. In the Old Testament law dictated that it is the blood that makes atonement for the soul, Leviticus 17:11. This is further explained in the New Testament in Hebrews 9:22, without the shedding of blood is no remission. Jesus said in Matthew 26:28, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for remission of sins. One wrong decision allowed rebel Satan, the rebel usurper, to alter God's creation into a lesser form. God had to put mankind into a linear existence as a holding pattern so he could not become eternally stuck in this lesser state. Genesis 3:22 says, behold, the man has become as one of us to know good and evil, and now lest he put forth his hand and also take of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden. This was the beginning of lunar time, human history as we know it today. Man had to leave the eternal realm for his own protection, separated from this intended home until a time when God would be able to restore all things. A common mistake is that if God is so powerful, why didn't he just change things then? Why wait? God has an order, a physics, on how things work and interrelate. I do not believe he will break his own rules. He can, but he doesn't. 2 Peter 3:8-9 says, but beloved, be not ignorant of one thing, for one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness, but is longsuffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. With this text in mind, imagine a pool clear, crystal clear pool of water, perfectly calm, reflective of the sky and trees like a mirror. Suddenly someone throws a rock into the middle of it. The reflection is gone and will not be experienced again until the last ripple has been played out by the action of that rock being thrown into the water. That is what linear time is. The resulting action of Eden must be carried out to the very finish. Every person that God intended to create must experience her own ripple in linear time. He does not tend to lose anyone that the Father has given him, according to John 10:27-28. When the last of God's seed has been born and given a chance to accept Christ, God can then put an end to the time and Satan. There is no battle being fought with an undetermined winner. God is merely putting up with Satan and his plans until his precious seed has come to fullness. Then he will harvest his wheat and gather the tares to be burned, Matthew 13:38-43. Tares are those that hear another voice and reject Christ. They are a different seed, the seed of the serpent. This is a sad reality and one that we may get into sometime later. Adam, the very name, means to be made red or ruddy, as flushed in the face. It also has a variation meaning lesser man. In the Bible, names have an important meaning. In Adam's case, it's almost prophetic. It was rather chilling to realize when I looked up the Hebrew name for blood, it's dam. And in this sense, that we have all truly been damned or made to have blood and destined to a physical death. Understanding the role blood has as one of the effects of a wrong decision made in Eden, you can see why there is such an emphasis on the shedding of Christ's blood as an atonement. The blood represents part of a literal mechanics and physics that was a paradox as part of an altered parallel universe. The atonement is the reversal action taken against this paradox to bring restoration. This has nothing to do with our moral condition as being good or bad or anything that could be earned or learned to get us out of this situation. We are helpless to get ourselves out of this paradox, and only one God himself could undo the paradox and restore us to our former promise of existence. It is in this sense and in this parallel universe model that it is only logical that only one God alone and only one could undo this. This leads us to our next video, which is the fact that there can be only one. In the last four parts of this series, we have learned that the Garden of Eden was an event that caused much more than the traditional stories reveal. Now, with a 21st century perspective and re-examination of the scriptures, a more logical and relatable story unfolds. The wrong decision in Eden by Adam and Eve resulted in a literal breach in the space-time concept of reality. A parallel dimension resulted from this decision that displaced mankind away from the eternal realm or higher dimension into a lesser one, the fallen one. With the exchange of a physical displacement also came a changed biology on the part of humanity to accommodate this new realm. The Bible is explicit in saying that mortal life is in the blood. This means that somehow the new fallen dimension is associated with the newly changed biological structure of mankind, now stuck in this linear existence. This was never intended for man, but was the result of a broken promise made by man to God not to partake from this other pathway or tree. This was also part of Satan's plan to usurp God and make an eternal realm for himself in this newly created paradox of reality. They both simultaneously exist side by side with each other. One is the perfect intention of what God created, and the other is a fallen one in need of redemption and reconciliation, and it will come to an end. Satan will fail. He will not eternalize this realm. We are warned that now all successive generations of mankind will automatically follow the ways of this lesser domain. You have nothing to do. You are a part of this paradox as a natural result of cause and effect. This is what is meant by original sin or sin nature. Sin is an ancient archery term meaning to miss the bullseye. In this sense, the bullseye was God's intended realm. We have all missed it. We have taken on the nature of our environment, that is this fallen dimension, and will just continue on to our own demise unless there is an intervention of some kind. This intervention means that the undoing of the cause and effect results would have to take place by someone untainted by this fall. It would have to be accomplished in a very specific, same but opposite fashion that caused the results in the first place. It is only common sense in this model that God is the only one untainted by this act. He would have to somehow come down willingly and do everything in the same but opposite of events that happened in Eden. He, only he, could do this, and only he could pay the price or perform the events that would undo this paradox. In this model, it is foolishly insane to think that man, unknowing of even where he is or why and how he got there, could earn or learn himself out of this condition. He is part of the problem, and tainted cannot even have be the solution. He is helpless to do anything about this trapped condition of existing in a parallel universe. Only God himself could come down to undo this. And that, in that sense,
there can be only one.
I want to make this illustration with a popular movie, if you could indulge me with this story. Let me bring you to the climax end of the movie Armageddon. The story in brief is that there is a comet about to hit Earth that will totally destroy it. The nations of Earth have a plan and send a team of people with the technical skills to drill and place atomic explosions into the comet that will destroy the comet or redirect it away from the Earth, thereby saving the entire globe. If it hits the Earth, it means the end of all things. Through the tense drama, their mission is about to fail as everyone of the team is safe aboard the ship, ready to leave except for one member. Our hero, Barry, Bruce Willis, decides to stay behind and finish the job at the cost of his own life. By process of elimination, he was the only one who could do this if he was willing, and he was. He made the decision and sacrificed his own life so his daughter, his best friend, and all of humanity may have a tomorrow. Now you would think after such a selfless act, a man that was willing to do this for all of humanity at the cost of his own life would be cherished and remembered for all time by all cultures and all people for this great act of selflessness and love. He would certainly be held in reverence and high esteem forever as the story of his heroic act would be passed down from generation to generation. But what if? What if in less
And 100 years later, people not only forgot what he did, they questioned that he even ever existed in the first place. What if those of his family remained true to history and preserved that truth, but nobody believed them? What if others came and said they actually were the ones that prevented this disaster? What if others said there was never a disaster, but they had a better plan and one that could, if one should ever happen? What if you persisted to cling to the truth and everybody else began to hate you for it? They called you intolerant and unjudgmental, and as you tried to explain that there was only one who accomplished this act. What if you woke up from this matrix dream and realized that it is you who have done this to the only one true God that already paid the price for your own survival? What if through this illustration you see yourself and what you have done to reject Jesus? I hate to compare Jesus to a character played by Bruce Willis, but what is it going to take to make some of you realize that this is exactly what you do every day by rejecting the gospel and the free offer that Jesus Christ did for you 2,000 years ago on a Roman cross? In the model of parallel dimensions, it is only logical that there can be only one. In light of this analogy, the most tolerant people on this planet are those who call themselves born-again Christians. I hope you may get a glimpse of what we go through daily. Imagine if your parents were the object of everyone's jokes or disgust. Imagine if you hear daily how your dad didn't exist or that he was everything but the truth you knew him to be. Or many were calling your mother a whore. You probably wouldn't stay calm for too long, would you? So what makes a Christian any different? We have to put up with this about our Heavenly Father and His only begotten Son every day of our lives. But we were warned that it would be like that, and we were encouraged to be like Jesus and love those who hate us, unlike others that say death to the infidel. We face this kind of hypocrisy by those who call us the hypocrites. I am sorry, but I'm going to be offensive here. What does it take to shake some of you into reality? We are in the end times, and all of our time is running short. You New Age Fruit Loops chasing the vanity of your own mind in a million ways, thinking all roads lead to your cosmic God. Secular humanists and atheists comfortable in your God-rejecting world of your so-called science and logic, whose concept you try to impose on others while tearing down the God you do not believe in. Followers of the moon god of Islam, deceived and deceivers, hell-bent on world conquest in any manner called jihad. Hindus who believe in hundreds of gods with the uncompassionate case system of karma whereby you have and get what you got because of your past life. Your system has left your societies miserably poor and unchanged because of your wrong beliefs. Buddhists who believe in the ultimate vanity of your own minds that you are God and actually learn by discipline to ascend into Godhead. And yet as a society, you go around in circles chasing after dead ideas that go nowhere. Taoists who believe that there are no absolutes can justify all of the atrocities of wars and killing associated with your cultures of feudalistic societies. And gee, isn't that an absolute statement in itself, that there are no absolutes? Psychobabble is all you imitators proclaim with dead fruit to prove your results. The one true God calls all of you thieves and robbers. Your gods and leaders did not pay any price for the world. They never sacrificed, but rather require you to sacrifice. They never claim to be the truth. They claim to know of the truth. Some may claim to be God or a prophet of him, but never claim to be God and were able to prove it. My Jesus did. He lived, died, and rose again. This is an amazing Bible story, but you know what? It's also recorded in secular history and by one who was hostile to the new Christian sect. Flavius Josephus was a Roman citizen who was a Jewish leader. While trying to win back favor to his fellow Jews, he wrote a definitive history of the Jews. He mentioned it in a brief description of one Jesus of Nazareth, who died and was seen days after alive by over 400 eyewitnesses. He had to mention this fact because it was well-known history in his day, just as Bruce Willis's character was in the movie of our day. I apologize for the bit of preaching, but I wanted to get your attention. I am not sitting in judgment of you as a good or bad person. I am not respecting your belief systems, and through this illustration from the Armageddon movie, perhaps you can see the emotion as my God is continually mocked and robbed of the person, the precious act that he did for us all. The Bible says that there is a real devil, and he is actively helping all of us to believe the disbelieve the truth and providing us with alternatives. There is only one way, one book, one God that claimed and revealed himself to us and told us that he was the only truth. He then proved it by willingly sacrificing himself and proving that he was God by raising from the dead again. He now offers us relationship, not religion, by receiving his Holy Spirit in us. We cannot earn our way out of this parallel dimension. We cannot learn our way out of this parallel dimension. We can only be as a child and come to him by faith and accept what he has done for us, which we could not do for ourselves.